this morning. The last funeral I did, I was just telling the family, was about a year ago, a little less than a year ago. And it was a very heavy service, unfortunately, because the man that we were eulogizing was a young man. He was a soldier who was killed in a car accident. He was only married a few years and left behind an infant daughter. But perhaps the hardest thing was that we were uncertain of his faith. Today's service is going to be so much different from that heavy service a year ago. Donna lived into her early 90s. She loved the Lord. Everybody around her knew it was the case. And she left a wonderful gift behind her. You can be sure that you will see her again if you know the Lord Jesus Christ. So welcome. Let me pray for us. Join me. Our Father, we begin as we just sung, rejoicing in your faithfulness, your steadfast love, your commitment to your children. And we thank you that we were able to see your faithfulness returned in Donna's life. We want so much for everything that is said here this morning and later at the graveside to honor you and to honor her. Lord, what a gift you have given to us and her, and we desire to see her rightly honored. So be with us. Help everyone who is speaking today. May their words be pleasing in your sight. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated. And you'll find the Lord's Day number one question and answer in your handout. Lord's Day number one. I'm going to read a question and then we'll respond together with the answer. So, Christian, what is your only comfort in life and in death?
That I am body and soul, both in life and death, and not my own, but belongs to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ, who with his precious blood has fully satisfied for all my sins and delivered me from all the power of the devil, and so preserves me that without the will of my heavenly Father, not a hair can fall from my head. Yea, that all things must be subservient to my salvation. Wherefore, by his Holy Spirit, he also assures me of eternal life, and makes me heartily willing and ready, and henceforth, to live with him.
The next hymn is found in is an insert. How Firm a Foundation. I invite you to once again find that and stand as we sing How Firm a Foundation.
Thank you.
God the Father's perspective, what names does Jesus give her? What is her true identity? Donna belonged to her faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. She was his treasured possession. She was loved with an everlasting love, engraved on the palm of his hand, redeemed, robed in his righteousness. Donna was one of his precious sheep, a child of the King, a faithful servant of Jesus Christ. Donna left a legacy of godliness in the lives of four wonderful children and their families, who will miss her very much. God be praised for the life of Donna Crawley. May the God of all comfort encourage each of you family members with his precious promises, his amazing grace, and his wondrous love. Lovingly submitted, Pastor Rob Campbell. So, which of the grandkids is coming first?
In case you don't know me, my name is Joseph Schooland. I am Gail Schooland's oldest child, Donna Carlman's fifth grandchild. And I'm reading this on behalf of Grandma's children, Uncle Steve, Uncle Dan, my mom, Laura. So this is written in their voice. Donna Lee Richards, our mother, was born August 1926 in Vancouver, Washington, to Faye and Hazel Richards. They lived 4 miles east of Hawkinson outside of Vancouver on a 160-acre parcel in a house with no electricity or water. Being the oldest of five children who were all born within 6 years, Mom had a position of responsibility practically from birth, helping her siblings and the many chores. Clothes were washed in tubs using washboards and water carried from the spring an eighth mile away. They put the clothes on the line to dry, then sprinkled them and rolled them up to be ironed by sad irons heated on the stove. This was a hard job on summer days, as the irons had to be heated by the fire to keep them hot, and the house got miserably hot. By the time Mom was 9 years old, she was milking the family cow. Later, her sister Bobby joined her. They each had a cow to milk every morning before school. Mom's cow had to be hobbled, as it was a kicker. The property was unfenced, so after school, the children had to trounce through the woods and hills to round up the cows to be milked again in the evening. They made butter from the cream and stored the milk in the cellar, as they had no refrigeration, along with beets, apples, carrots, onions, and potatoes from their huge vegetable garden. Mom was set in charge of her younger siblings, Barbara, Kathleen, Jimmy, and Benny, and was relied on by her mother. She was said to be bossy, but in later years, all her siblings realized the enormity of her task and said they wouldn't want to keep track of four little kids and taking that job so seriously. There was not much money and life was hard work, but there was also homemade fun to be had too. Five children played hide and seek in the bracken ferns, took picnic lunches to their favorite big rock in the middle of the field, climbed the crooked tree, and played in the creek on the property. They built dams to make the water level rise up to their knees, watching out for crawdads that could pinch, and sometimes the children fished off the ridge. Mom and her siblings picked wild blackberries, huckleberries, and strawberries, along with gooseberries and raspberries, which were all preserved. They roamed the hills and woods and learned the names of wildflowers and trees. All of us know Mom had vast knowledge of plants and flowers and cultivated them wherever we lived. She especially loved trilliums and dogwood trees. Mom's family was musical and learned many old songs, which they sang together often. Mom received a second-hand guitar from her grandparents when she was 11 years old and learned to play. They walked a mile to the school bus carrying sticks in case they met up with cougars or bears. Mom graduated from high school and then went to Washington State College, which is before it was called Washington State University, for 1 year of college. And she worked in an office at the shipyard for a year, and then at Barnes Hospital from 1946 to 1952. This was in Vancouver, and she had room and board in the home of the mayor. Mom's parents got divorced about this time, and Mom sent some of her earnings home to our grandmother to help meet her needs. Mom also had two half-brothers. They were quite a bit older. Uncle Monty passed away over 15 years ago at age 87. Uncle Edgar died in World War II on the banks of Normandy at age 23. Uncle Jimmy and Uncle Benny also have passed, leaving her two sisters, Aunt Bobby in Oregon and Aunt Katie in Carson, Washington. Dad and Mom met at the NCO club, which held dances. Dad was in the Air Force home on furlough, and he was with his best friend, who happened to be Mom's cousin. Being in the service, Dad had to go away, but they wrote every day. When he came back on a 3-week furlough, they got married, a small wedding, and Mom became Mrs. Jack Carlin. They were off to start their life together in the Air Force. Newly married, they drove across the country to the East Coast. Mom was in awe of the majesty and beauty of the landscape. She began to ask herself questions. How did this get here? Is there God somewhere? Where would I go if I died? Our parents spent time on the East Coast and decided they should start going to church since it seemed a good thing to do. They both attended neighborhood churches in their childhood, and Dad had been baptized when he was 12 years old. But neither one understood the meaning of the Christian faith. They started attending the chapel on base. Mom said later that one sermon she heard made her heart burn. She knew she had found her answers in the truth. This was in 1953 when Mom became a Christian. She said her growth as a Christian was very slow, and she had a hard time understanding her Bible. They were transferred to different locations, and the chapel sermons were sometimes shallow, and the people were transient. Dad received orders to Amarillo, Texas, where Steve was born, then to McCord Air Force Base, Washington, where Dan was born. When they moved to Fairbanks, Alaska, God providentially brought a minister to their door who invited them to church. In this small, close-knit Fairbanks Christian Reformed Church, they found a church family and were carefully discipled in the faith. Reverend Van Hook was their pastor, and he met with them every week, teaching them and answering their questions. This laid a strong foundation for their life ahead. Mom was baptized along with Steve and Dan. Gail was born shortly after. They were stationed again in Texas, then moved to Hawaii, where Laura was born, and where they were also blessed to belong to a small congregation forming a new Christian Reformed church. Dad retired from the Air Force at his last post in Atwater, California in 1967. They bought a house on 32 acres in Eatonville, Washington. The place was overgrown and run down, needing repairs and improvements. It was a busy few years of building fences, corrals, a new house, and clearing land. For us kids, it was a wonderland, with horses to ride, dogs and puppies, cats and kittens, and woods to explore and build forts in. The boys cut trees and burned brush, helped Dad with the building, broke horses to ride, raised rabbits, and we all felt we were living in the frontier days. Within a few years, the old red house was moved to a new location 5 miles down the road, and we moved into the new house we had built on the property. Mom was always busy. She gardened, canned, cleaned, sewed, baked, and cooked meals. She was creative and had many talents: crocheting, knitting, quilting, candle making, toll painting, embroidery, calligraphy, crewel, cross-stitching. She made Christmas ornaments and wreaths and had the patience and expertise to make perfect candy and bake the best Christmas cookies. Mom was quiet about her accomplishments, but everything she did well. She loved music, and we always had music playing in our home. She enjoyed all kinds: classical, cowboy songs, hymns, waltzes. The Sound of Music soundtrack, gospel music, instrumentals, Handel's Messiah, etc. She was so excited to receive a record player one Christmas that could play a stack of 6 records instead of just a single. She had a beautiful singing voice and could play the guitar. On our 2-hour trips to visit Grandma Richards, we'd ask her to sing Cowboy Jack, Old Shep, and other country songs. We would join in the singing too. Mom loved nature and wildlife. She was most excited to take us and the grandkids Northwest Trek, which was only 5 miles from the house we grew up in. We'd ride the tram looking out the windows to see bears, wolves, and bison in their natural habitat. Dad made bird feeders and bird houses so she could watch the birds from her window while working in the kitchen. When the swallows were building nests, Mom would call us to watch them. We would let go of lint and fuzz off of the deck, and the swallows would swoop them up and carry off the material to their birdhouses. She never tired of watching the hummingbirds drink from the feeders hanging in the front of the window. She often commented on these magnificent little creatures with long beaks and amazing wings. She loved Mount Rainier, always calling attention to the fluffy clouds adorning it, the sun casting a beautiful orange hue over it, and missed it on the days it was hidden by the clouds. In the early 70s, Mom began following politics more closely. Both she and Dad got involved by going to caucus meetings, researching the candidates and ballot issues, gathering signatures for petitions, and voting in every election, big or small. Mom was especially interested in the issues that directly impacted the family and religious freedoms. She faithfully wrote to her congressmen and senators, and she prayed for our nation. She was always knowledgeable and encouraging, knowing that God is working and accomplishing His will even when things seem dismal. Being married to an Air Force man and knowing what it was like to move often, Mom was good about having servicemen over for meals with our family on Sundays and holidays. She also had a special place in her heart for single moms, the elderly, and shut-ins. We don't know how she found out about them, but she always seemed to have a family to bring a meal to, a single mom to give clothes to, and other practical items such as dishes and furniture. She did this work quietly. All of us know how much Mom loved the Lord and how much she wanted us to know Him. She prayed for her children, grandchildren, and in-law children faithfully. What a privilege to have a mother and grandmother who prayed so earnestly for her offspring. It is a blessing to see the Lord working out answers to those prayers even today. In later years, Mom developed Alzheimer's. This limited her conversation abilities, but it did not limit her desire to be used by God, to serve Him, and to trust Him. She taught us much in her outward focus of love for us around her, her patience, and her submission. It was a blessing to help in her care, and we have many happy memories. She was a joy, and His light shone through her. Ask the other grandkids to come up.
My name is Danny, and I'm Steve's youngest daughter, and Donna's 11th grandchild, and I'm going to be reading some thoughts specifically from my dad. In my memories, Mom was never very outspoken, unless we asked for it. She was always firm in her belief in the Lord and committed to raising our family to love Him as well. That was her number one priority. Being in the Air Force, my dad got a new assignment every 2 or 3 years. Even though I know it must have been hard on her, I don't remember ever hearing Mom complain about all the moving. All 4 of us kids were born in different states. Dan here in Madigan, Gail in Alaska, Laura in Hawaii, and I in Texas, which I guess explains the cowboy boots. When we moved to the farm in Eatonville after Dad retired, all 6 of us lived in a 16-foot travel trailer for a couple of months while Dad did repairs on the old farmhouse, and they both got the house ready to move in. It needed a lot of work. If Mom complained, I never heard. Mom enjoyed sewing, and I'm afraid I took for granted all the shirts she made for me. I got a lot of good comments on them. She was also a talented quilter and made one for each of us kids and all 4 of my kids, probably most of the other grandchildren as well. She did it because she loved us and never expected anything in return. Mom had a servant's heart and was happiest when she was in that role. She loved music and started teaching me to play the guitar when I was 7 or 8 years old. Mom picked us up after school when we were going to TBS, and for our 30-minute drive home, she always had something for us to eat. My favorite was her banana bread with homemade butter from her cow Esther, whom Dad milked every morning and night. I got to milk her a few times, but wasn't as good as Dad. We had her for 2 or 3 years and got a couple calves from her. Here are some of the things Mom taught me. She taught me how to get pieces of eggshell out of the eggs in the pan by using another eggshell. She taught me how to make banana pancakes out of the squishy bananas. She taught me how to flip pancakes when the bubbles were starting to burst. She taught me to open the door for girls or anybody and let them go first. She taught me to walk on the curbside of whom I'm walking with. She tried to teach me to be a gentleman, and she did a great job. Mom's divinity and fudge at Christmas time were to die for, and I can still remember the smell of the roast in the oven when we would get home from church on Sunday afternoons. One thing both Dad and Mom taught me was to tithe. From the time I was very little, I remember learning how important it was to tithe a tenth of my money. If I made a dime, the tithe was 1 cent. If I made a dollar, 10 cents was the tithe. That was ingrained in me from an early age. Dad loved fishing and had a boat, a few different boats, that he took to CQ. Mom didn't share his enthusiasm, but didn't want to dampen his. She spent many hours in the boat with us, read a few books, and caught a few fish. She would have a good reason to complain, but never did. Mom would later can some of the fish back in the camper as they were caught, and she enjoyed being productive. Mom loved to work outside in the yard and garden and took pride in all the different varieties of rhododendrons and azaleas that adorned the grounds around the house. In Mom's later years, her sense of humor could catch us off guard. Laura brought her down shortly after Dad passed away to visit the gravesite. We had had a headstone placed for Mom next to Dad's with her name on it. When she saw it, she exclaimed, "Oh, that's me." In the last few years, even though she didn't know who we were, she could still remember the words to the old hymns and loved to sing them and could still pray beautiful prayers. Her Christian faith meant everything to her. She was not afraid to die, but rather looked forward to heaven and spending her time worshiping the Savior she loves. I have no doubt that Mom would be thrilled to know that we are having her memorial service today, the day after we celebrate the fact that Jesus Christ gave himself as a loving sacrifice for our sins, and the day before we celebrate his rising from the grave and defeating the enemy forever. I know she is celebrating with Jesus now, in a new perfect body, together with all those who have gone on before her. Mom was a great example to me in life and in death. I thank God for the assurance that I will see her again, thanks to the sacrifice that Jesus made for all of us. Thank you, Mom. I love you.
My name is Joel Carlman. I'm the youngest son of Dan Carlman and Donna's fourth grandchild. I'm happy to share some of my dad's thoughts about his mother. God always came first. When Mom and Dad were young marrieds and Dad was stationed in Alaska, a young pastor from the Christian Reformed Church knocked on their door and invited them to church. This began an involvement in church life and a lifelong love of God that colored everything my mom did. They said, stay friends with the Fendenhook family and got a lot of mentoring from Reverend Fendenhook, the young pastor along the way. Mom loved God, and a close second was her family. She did almost everything with us in mind. Mom was always making things. She made them for other people, but I think it helped her express her creativity. She made beautiful hand sewn quilts for many of her kids and grandkids. I had one myself that took hundreds and hundreds of hours to make. She sewed shirts and dresses, experimented in the kitchen with baked goods and candy. Her divinity was the best candy you could have, and her fudge was right there too. She canned plums, pears, cherries, peaches, applesauce, and vegetables. She made butter and jellies and jams. Mom wasn't someone who did things for recognition. If she made someone something or said something to a person, they could rest assured it came from her heart with no ulterior motive. She was a fervent prayer warrior, praying for her family, those she knew needed prayer. In her last years, one thing my sister brought to my attention was that even though her thoughts were muddled and she couldn't keep things straight in her mind, her spirit maintained a clear communication with God, as evidenced by her prayers. She might have a confusing day and ask the same things over and over again throughout the day, but her prayers were always clear. Her spirit was always able to commune with God without the confusion. That is a mystery to me, but God was in love with that part of Mama, her true self. She was a beautiful, true, and faithful daughter, and he took great delight in her. I have always thought that the sweetness and childlike nature that she has exhibited as she got older was really what her unguarded soul was like. The Bible says, man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. I believe what we have seen of Mom in these last years has been her core being exposed for all to see. A soul that was anchored in faith. When trials came and her abilities were limited, what is important in life is what she clung to. I'm so glad that we were able to get a glimpse of what I think, what I came to think of as her heavenly personality before we all get to see her again in heaven. Mom and Dad started a family all those years ago in Alaska that went on to touch many people. I know of pastors who are serving God because of contact with what God started, and there are three generations and counting of followers of Jesus Christ in our family because of the example that they set. Thank you, Mom, for that greatest gift of all, teaching us about eternity with God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And thank you for loving us with all you have.
In case you forgot, I am Joseph Schooland, Gail Schooland's first child, and Grandma's fifth grandchild. And these are my mom's thoughts. I spent much of my childhood outdoors, rain or shine. In our little red house, there was a utility porch off of the kitchen. After a day of playing with puppies, horses, or making force in the woods or barn, I'd come in, Mom would put newspaper down for dirty boots and clothes and have me wash up good. Mom always had a hearty, delicious meal on the table. Often we ate late when Dad got home from work, but we always ate together. One time, Dad killed an ornery rooster. We had company and Mom cooked up the bird for us to eat. It was our first time eating home-cooked chicken. We were all excited. It actually tasted, well, like an old, tough, dried-up bird. That was the only disappointing and inedible meal I ever remember that Mom cooked, but we had a good laugh about it then and years later. I came in running from the barn one day very upset. Mama cat was eating her kittens. Mom came out to the barn with me and saw immediately that there was no hope. The kittens were born very premature. She gently explained to me that the baby kittens couldn't live, and it was nature's way of taking care of the problem. I was quite distressed, but comforted to learn that God created animals with instincts to know what to do. Mom was usually busy cleaning and getting dinner ready when I got home from school. She was a worker, didn't always pick up on moods or what we were feeling, just focused on getting tasks done. I got off the school bus one day. I was feeling horrible and not responding to Mom's request to get the table set. She was exasperated with me, and I burst out crying. Immediately, she was concerned as I told her I had brought my favorite pink ball to school to play foursquare with. On the bus ride home, we were having fun playing keep away with it when one of the mean older boys threw my ball out the bus window. This was a traumatic end to my school day. Mom hopped me and her in the car, and we went to look for it. I found the field it got thrown into, but we never did see my pink ball. Just knowing Mom realized how serious it all was and how badly I felt made me feel much better, and maybe it wasn't such a serious thing after all. When I was in middle school, Mom took me with her to see Fiddler on the Roof. We were entranced with the movie. There was a disruptive commotion. A streaker ran across the stage from one side of the screen to another. Streaker means he was totally unclothed, running fast, a fad in the 70s. It was a shock to the audience, bringing an eruption of gasps, then quietness, and then finally peals of laughter. I did not know what to think, or what would Mom think. I peeked up at her and saw that after the initial shock, she got the giggles and started laughing. I sort of laughed also, although I wondered why we were laughing at a naked man running across the stage. It seemed like a very wrong thing for him to do. Later on the way home, Mom said she was so disappointed that that had to happen during her favorite part and song of the movie. My parents were new Christians when I was growing up, and they had much to learn about their faith along with marriage and parenting. They broke ground that was very new to them. My strongest memory was Mom's faithfully reading God's word and her prayers. Her prayers were earnest. She loved the Lord and clung to him. When I had a problem or struggle, Mom would passionately say, "Gail, have you prayed about it? Are you reading your Bible?" Which wasn't what I liked to hear. I wanted an immediate answer. I had learned how right Mom is. Praying in God's word is the answer. Not just for trials, but everything in our lives. Mom knew the importance and blessing of prayer. She prayed for her children, grandchildren, and in-law children faithfully. What a huge blessing to me that I realize even more now how Mom prayed for God to guide me and keep me. Just shortly before Mom's passing, I said to her, "I am so thankful for your example to me, Mom. You have been so brave, obedient, and faithful." She has been much more than that than I can even begin to express. She was in a weak, frail state, but she said, "Oh, I am thankful to be that." I said, "You are thankful to be an example to me?" She said, "Yes," and held my hand tightly. God had a purpose for her, even to the end of her life, and he has worked much in my heart and soul through my time with her. I am thankful for the mother that he gave me.
So I am Isaac Ungersma. I am Laura Ungersma's third-born oldest boy. I am the 13th grandchild. These are her thoughts. "When I started kindergarten, the teacher noticed that I had trouble seeing the blackboard and told Mom, who brought me to the eye doctor. I did indeed need glasses. When the glasses arrived, Mom and I went to pick them up, and all the way home I was exclaiming, 'Oh, look at the birds! Mom, look at the trees! Is that Mount Rainier? Wow!' Later, I found out that Mom was practically in tears on that trip home. She felt terrible that she didn't know I was so nearsighted, but how could she have known? She didn't have a blackboard at our house, and I just thought cars, people, mountains, trees, and the rest of the world were supposed to look like blobs. At the age of 6, I asked Mom if I could take piano lessons. She and Dad agreed, and I ended up taking piano all through high school and into college, where I also began organ lessons. I remember many occasions in my younger years when I didn't want to practice, but Mom would push me along, something I am so thankful for now. She loved it when any of us kids pursued learning an instrument and would encourage us to keep it up. All throughout middle school and high school, Mom would say to me immediately after dinner, 'How about if you go play the piano while I do the dishes?' Gail also learned the piano, Steve learned the guitar and baritone, and Dan learned the guitar and harmonica. Every year for Gail's and my piano recital, Mom would make us new dresses, usually working late into the night. I can still remember being lulled to sleep by the sound of her sewing machine. I thought she sewed long after everyone else went to bed because she liked being up most of the night and didn't need sleep. Much later in life, I realized that she had been so busy caring for her family in other ways throughout the day, the late evenings were the only opportunities she had to work on projects like recital dresses. In later years, she made baby quilts for all the grandchildren, and every year at Christmas, she gave all the grandchildren new pajamas which she had made. It was all a labor of love. Around 1979 or 1980, when I was just beginning high school, Mom attended a seminar by Verna Berkey called You Are Very Special. Mrs. Berkey used humor and God's word to teach women about their value in the eyes of God. At her seminars, she gave all the women attendees cassettes that had a number of hymns that reinforced the truth that God is our Heavenly Father, and that He made us, He knows us, loves us, and is intimately involved in every detail of our lives. I remember Mom listening to her cassette over and over. She especially loved the hymn, Children of the Heavenly Father, which we will sing together today. She told me with a smile on her face and joy in her eyes, that God loved her and me personally. He carries us close to himself. Nothing can ever sever us from his love. He knows our sorrows. He is our defender. He will never forsake us. I agreed with her, but I was puzzled at the time why she was so impressed with this truth. Having grown up in a secure Christian home and in the church, it was a truth that had been easy for me to grasp from a young age. It wasn't until later years that I realized how life-changing that knowledge was for Mom. Her earthly father had been selfish and cruel. He wasn't a trustworthy man and used flattery to manipulate. He wasn't one to affirm or encourage his children. Before that seminar, she had known that God had saved her from her sins and that she wanted to live a life of obedience to him in gratitude for his gift of salvation and eternal life. But she had a deep sense of not being able to measure up and felt that she had to earn his approval some way. It was a very heavy burden for her. The Holy Spirit used her in a seminar to transform Mom's understanding. Mom had always been very dutiful, but now there was real joy in her duties because she was loved deeply, completely, and eternally by her Heavenly Father, the God of all creation. Mom felt her shortcomings so strongly, but she always knew that what she needed was God's wisdom and strength. When I was in high school, I was looking for something in our family's desk and noticed a notebook. Not realizing what it was at first, I started leafing through it and saw in Mom's handwriting my name, the names of all our family members, including in-laws and grandchildren, and the names of many others who had needs, and I realized that it was a prayer notebook. Later, when I asked her about it, she told me that she read her Bible every morning and spent time with the Lord in prayer, praying for all the things in the book. That was a habit that Mom kept up until she was no longer able to think of it on her own. For the last 5 years of her life, she would need to be reminded to pray before eating her breakfast. She immediately would. Her prayers were different every day, even in the advanced stages of Alzheimer's, but the underlying theme of every prayer was a heart overflowing with gratitude and praise to her Heavenly Father. She thanked him for her new friends that she had made, for his faithful provision in giving her much more than she needed, for his love for her, for the people that helped her each day. And she would almost always ask the Lord to bless those who cared for her. Her last prayer that I remember her praying at the breakfast table before she became bedridden mid-February of 2017 was a prayer that was said in the midst of much garbled speech. These sentences were crystal clear. Heavenly Father, lead me into the best possible way. Teach me your way. Praise you, my Heavenly Father. Lead me into your home. Amen. I called Gail in tears and said, Gail, the Holy Spirit is comforting Mom again. To which she agreed and then said, Laura, I think he is also comforting you. I think that is what encouraged me the most in caring for Mom. That her strong faith that she had had from the first moment she felt her heart burning when she heard the message on Abraham and raised her hand to receive Christ was what was sustaining her through the most difficult task of her life. Growing old and living with the effects of advancing Alzheimer's. What a heritage.
and Jim and Laura the last 6 years, and we all took care of her. Laura and I want to share what Mom gave to us in her last years and in spite of the disease and after years. Mom's life reminds us how God's purpose for us here on earth is not done until we take our last breath. Mom gave me joy, comfort. She was such an example. She could say things to make me chuckle. Like, one morning, I was helping Mom get ready for the day. She was moving slow and kept saying, "Oh, I have this word in my head." I asked, "What is the word, Mom?" She said slowly, "It is supercalifragilisticexpialidocious." So we sang Edelweiss till we got that word out of our head. After singing Edelweiss, Mom asked me what Edelweiss meant, and I told her it meant snow. She kept saying, "I wonder what Edelweiss means. It means snow, Mom." She would look at me funny. Later, Cassie told me that Edelweiss meant flower. Clearly, Mom knew I didn't know what I was talking about. This was one of our actually lighthearted, happy conversations, although it may seem a sad story to you. Mom was trying to figure out my name. She knew I was related to her and asked me, "What is your name?" I said, "It's Gail." "Dale? Gail?" "No, Mom, it's Gail." "Dale? Spell it for me." G-A-I-L. "Dale?" "No, Mom, Gail Diane. I am your daughter." "I am your daughter?" "No, you are the mom. I am the daughter." Finally, she leaned back in her chair, gave a shrug, and smiled real big. She laughed and said, "Oh, well, we will accumulate it in the morning." I laughed and said, "What does that mean?" Mom laughed and said, "I don't know." I said, "It's okay, Mom. I remember things for both of us." She laughed and said, "That's good." It was hard on occasion to not get a tear in my eye or to not feel sad when I sat on the bed next to Mom or by her chair. She would reach over and pat my arm to comfort me. Because we spent so much time together, I often knew what she was trying to convey, even if her words got mixed up or she couldn't get them out. Sometimes we'd have a good laugh over the confusion, but other times it would make Mom sad. This time, when Mom asked me who I was, I explained that I was her daughter. She immediately said, "Oh, I am so sorry." She sadly said, "If you keep telling me, maybe I'll remember." I knew it bothered her not to remember something that important. I would encourage her by saying, "It's okay, Mom. I will keep track of the important things. We know we love each other." She would smile and say, "Yes, we do." She was my mom, comforting, caring, concerned. When I fed her breakfast, she would ask if I had eaten my breakfast yet. She would say, "Thank you. You are wonderful. God bless you. I love you very, very much." She expressed those sort of words many times in many ways, even to the end of her life. In 2013, Mom had broken her hip and was in a rehab facility. She could not remember where she was or that she had had surgery and should not get out of bed. She could not remember why she would get stabbing pain if she moved a certain way. It was all confusing for her. One morning, I was in her room with her for her breakfast. The tray came, and Mom exclaimed over the food, "What is this? It's a piece of watermelon, Mom. Oh, it looks delicious." She commented on the beautiful sunny day. She prayed before eating, and her prayer went like this: "Dear Father, thank you for all this good food to eat. Thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for all the wonderful people who are caring for me." She stopped a moment, then continued, "Help me, Lord, to be worthy of their care. In Jesus' name, amen." Amazing. Mom could not remember where she was, that she had pain from a broken hip. She couldn't even remember what watermelon was. But she could remember that she needed help from God and wanted him to show her how she could serve him. Mom was a worker from the time she was a toddler helping her own mother. She gave of herself. She was an example of showing that serving is not only doing, it is also being. Even with this illness, she is appreciative, kind, joyful, patient. She was a light in the room, and she was being used by him. Mom became weaker and slower and needed help with everything. We walked alongside her with her walker. Many times she would say, "Thank you for caring for me." And with compassion, she would say, "What do people do who have no one to help them?" It was a joy to serve her, although truly, Mom was serving and ministering to me. Mom didn't forget how to walk a year ago, and from that time on, she was bedbound. She never left her bed. My brother Dan commented that Mom was always steadfast in her faith, whatever she faced. That is so true. She didn't let Alzheimer's be an excuse. She persevered more than anyone I know. What a privilege to have her example. The last thing I want to share, as Steve, my brother, pointed out to me, is a real gift. Many mornings when getting Mom ready, she and I would sing in her roomy bathroom with the great acoustics. She knew songs from the 40s, cowboy songs, Irish songs, hymns. She had a beautiful voice and harmonized beautifully too. I loved singing with her and thought that singing was one thing we would have together until she was gone. But last March, right after becoming bedbound, Mom lost her ability to carry a tune. Her voice was weak. She still sang pretty songs, but they were not recognizable in tune or words. One night, just a few months ago, I was trying to get Mom settled for bed so we could sleep. She was talking and talking. When I say talking, I mean murmuring quietly, words and sentences that made sense to her, but not to me. I got out of bed, went to Mom, and said, "Mom, it's after midnight, time to go night-night." I kissed her on the forehead, tucked her in, and she said, "Okay, good night." She lay quietly, then started talking and resting around. After a while, I got out of bed. "Mom, aren't you tired? It's after 1 in the morning. Let's go to sleep." I kissed her forehead and crawled back into my bed. She was agreeable, but after a while started talking again. This went on a lot of the night, and the last time I tucked her in, kissed her, and crawled back to bed, she was quiet. After a while, she said, "Gail?" I laid there alert, listening. She hadn't said my name for a long while. I didn't answer her. I only laid there quiet. And Mom began to sing. She sang the song slowly, deliberately, in perfect tune, with every word perfect. It was the second verse of "O Come All Ye Faithful." "Sing, choir of angels, sing in exaltation. O sing, all ye bright hosts of heaven above. Glory to God, all glory in highest. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord." I was amazed, and while she was singing, I was thinking, "Don't forget the words, Mom. Don't trail off confused. Don't go off tune. Keep singing." She sang the words. It was beautiful. I lay there quiet. Mom lay there quiet. And then we both went to sleep. That song, that verse gave me peace and comfort for what was ahead. We knew Mom wouldn't be with us much longer. Every time I thought of Mom's passing, I envisioned what she would soon be a part of. Singing with choirs of angels, singing in exaltation, singing with the bright host of heaven above, giving glory to God in the highest, adoring him, adoring Christ the Lord. Now I envision her thinking with clarity, being full of joy and laughter, being elated to meet Jesus, who she strived to know and to follow in her life. That verse Mom was saying was a gift to me, and I hope it is a gift to you, if you have lost a loved one or thinking about your own passing from this life. Envisioning what we have to look forward to and what our loved ones who are with Jesus are experiencing. We are burying Mom's body this afternoon, and it seems so final, such a letting go. But the burying of her body is not the end of her story. Mom's soul is with Jesus now, called to be a part of. Her children, her grandchildren, her great-grandchildren, and all her loved ones, all of us here. She lived her life in faith and trust in God, not wavering from the truth, and she had an urgency about all things of God. I know her prayers that we all share with her is faith in Him. Long called me one day in April 2004 and said, I went to the doctor today and he thinks that I'm in the beginning stages of Alzheimer's. I can't recall our exact conversation, but Mom expressed that though it wasn't the path that she wanted, she knew God would walk it with her. I assured her that we would walk it with her as well. None of us knew what the next 14 years were going to hold. We could only walk it out one day at a time as God unfolded His plan for us. In our minds, we envisioned that we would be helping Mom as she slowly faded away and that we would be losing her piece by piece. We didn't realize then how the Holy Spirit would continue working in and through her to minister to her and to teach us and to bless us. Mom led the way by putting her full faith and confidence in her loving Heavenly Father. She never complained or allowed herself to become bitter. She didn't fret or feel sorry for herself. As Gail has shared, Mom kept her sense of humor and had an underlying joy that was contagious. She made us laugh and laughed with us. She also maintained an amazing outward focus, even as the disease progressed and she couldn't place who we were, or sometimes even who she was. You are wonderful. I love you. Thank you. God bless you for all things that we heard her say over and over and over again. Mom was bedridden the last year of her life. She lay in bed day after day, night after night. But even then, she didn't complain. She listened to music and would try to sing along to the familiar old songs and hymns that she loved. Throughout Mom's Christian life, she was faithful in prayer and was able to pray simple, coherent prayers even up until about a year ago. In those prayers, she always thanked the Lord for His faithful provision for her and would ask Him to bless her wonderful new friends who were caring for her. That was her family. Even after she could no longer formulate sentences at will, she spent hours every day with her hands folded, eyes closed, lips moving, speaking to her Heavenly Father. We knew He understood what she was saying to Him, and her faithfulness in trusting Him blessed us. She greeted everyone who came into the room with a smile and was always a hostess, even as she lost more and more of her ability to speak sentences or words. As her speech and language became more garbled, she would amaze us every now and then by speaking a crystal clear sentence, always words of affirmation, thanksgiving, encouragement, and faith. There were many precious times when Mom couldn't keep things straight, but her sweet spirit would come through. One of my journal entries from about a year ago says, "My dear Mom was so tired when she went to bed tonight. She was having trouble praying. Her prayer went something like this. Heavenly Father, thank you for these people that are taking such good care of me. Please bring Dad and Mom here soon so they know I'm safe. Help us to go right to sleep." Long pause. "Help us to have a good night of sleep." Another long pause. "Good night. Sleep tight. Don't let the bed bugs bite." I could just sense God smiling down on His daughter, Donna. Mom's desire for her children and her grandchildren throughout our lives was that we know and love God. That continued to be her strongest desire up until the end of her life. One night, Last October, Mom was very restless and agitated. Just Titus and I were home that night, and we tried for some time to calm her. But over time, it became apparent that she had something on her mind that she needed to say to us. Eventually, she was able to get some words out. Love, God, family, church. And we began to understand that she was exhorting us to always be faithful in our love for God and His Word, and that she wanted her entire family to know Him. Once we began understanding what she was trying to communicate to us, we responded in turn, reassuring her that we do love God and His Word, and that we will always be faithful in attending church. We also thanked her for teaching us about God and pointing us to Christ, and for praying for all of her family members so faithfully throughout the years. Once she realized that we understood, she began smiling and laughing and hugging us. She seemed to feel so much better, like one does when they have something heavy on their heart and are finally able to talk it out and have that weight lifted. She slept peacefully after that. Just this past December, as Jim and I were about to get Mom ready for bed one night, she took my hand in both of hers, looked at my face intently, and said earnestly over and over, "I love you so, 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 so much. You are such a sweet girl. Thank you, thank you, thank you." Then she leaned back and started saying, "Heaven, heaven, heaven," over and over. Then she would look at me and over at Jim and say, "Thank you so, so, so much. I love you, I love you, I love you." And we close her eyes again and say, "Heaven, heaven, heaven." This went on for 45 minutes, Mom earnestly looking at me and over at Jim and telling us repeatedly of her love for us, thanking us, and quietly repeating the word, "Heaven." It was as if she had one foot on earth and one in heaven. It was a gift to all three of us. One night, a few months ago, Jim and I were getting things ready for Mom's nighttime routine. She was quietly talking gibberish and watching us. All of a sudden, she exclaimed in clear speech, "We are going to have a wonderful time with Jesus Christ." I ran to her bedside and said, "Oh, yes, Mom, we are going to have a wonderful time with Him forever and ever." I will never forget the smile that she had on her face or the sparkle in her eyes. Mom taught us what contentment, trust, obedience, thankfulness, and patience look like in the face of trials for a Christian. She taught us what it looks like to cling to God when everything else is falling away. We have been most richly blessed to have the privilege of caring for her till the Lord took her to heaven and spoke His, "Well done, my faithful servant." She ran her race faithfully. May each of us do the same. So we're going to show a slideshow now of Mom's life.
Thank you. and she sings around the house. She's got a voice that knocks me out. She's my favorite singer. But you won't see her on TV or hear her on the radio. Worldly fame is not her aim. She's the first to let you know. She wants to be a homemaker. It's her dream to raise a family and give her love to just one man. Not that God is me. I'll never underestimate her, for she could take this world and turn it on. But she takes her love and makes our house a home. The kids to bed. She making sure the prayers get said before she lays down with me. It's plain to see that she's not seeking glory on this earth. She believes in honesty and the joy of giving birth. She wants to be a home. It's her dream to raise a family, give her love to just one man. Not that God's me, I'll never underestimate her, but she could take this world and turn it on. But she takes her love, makes our house a home. Thank you.
we continue to honor Donna by singing one of her favorite hymns that we just heard. Children of the Heavenly Father, you'll find that in your walk in this family. So. Nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation wanted me to preach from Romans 8, verses 13 to 18. And I know what you're all thinking right now. You're hoping that I have at least a 45-minute sermon. And I'm sorry to disappoint you. But if you care to turn up the passage, Romans 8, 13 through 18, I want to say a few words by way of context. Really, chapter 6, 7, and 8 belong together. He just finished treating, Paul had just finished treating the doctrine of justification. He now turns to sanctification. Sanctification is the lifelong process by which all of our motives, passions, desires, thoughts, words, and actions are conformed to Christ's. As I have taught the book of Romans to high school students over many years, I would photocopy the chapters with wide margins so they could take notes on the side and use highlighters to highlight key phrases and words. When we came to chapters 6, 7, and 8 on sanctification, I asked them to read all three chapters together and highlight every reference to the Holy Spirit. And what they find is this. There are zero references to the Holy Spirit in chapter 6. There is one in chapter 7. And there is a whopping 20 in Romans chapter 8. Chapter 7 emphasizes the crippling, debilitating power of indwelling sin. While chapter 8 emphasizes the conquering and enabling power of the indwelling Spirit. And so naturally, between chapter 7 and 8, there is a huge mood shift from one of despair and frustration to one of hope. Praise God for Romans chapter 8. One year, as I photocopied off the book and was handing them out to my students, one of my students raised her hands and said, Pastor Mass, I don't seem to have chapter 8 in my copy. Mine goes from chapter 7 to chapter 9. And then another raised their hands. Most of them had the book of Romans in its entirety, but a few somehow skipped out on chapter 8. And I think the copy machine made that mistake to put this thought in my head, which I'm going to put in your head right now. Imagine the book of Romans without chapter 8. Can you imagine a chapter that begins with there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus and ends with there is no separation from the love of God in Christ Jesus? No condemnation, no separation. No wonder Jack Packer refers to Romans 8 as a rhapsody of Christian assurance. How impoverished would Romans be without chapter 8? How impoverished would the Bible be without Romans 8? So rich and so full of comfort and encouragement. No wonder Donna wants so much of it read and preached at her funeral. The saints from all over the world and at all times have been profoundly influenced by its truths. The particular passage Donovan and I preached is full of contrasts. If you were to study it, you'd see lived and died, flesh and spirit, spirit of slavery, spirit of adoption, suffer with Christ, glorified with Christ, present sufferings and future glory. It's also the first time Paul brings up the topic of adoption in his letter to the Romans. Much of what this passage is about is adoption and its fruits. Here are my four, I promise you, brief points. Because of our adoption, we experience intimacy with the Father. assurance of our belonging to the family of God. A glorious future inheritance and present sufferings. Would you follow along as I read? For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. And now imagine your life without this verse. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Would you pray with us? Oh, Father, we thank you that you did more than pardon our sins, that you brought us into your family. Help us more and more to experience our adoption, even as we're sure that God will come. In Christ's name. So because of our adoption, we get to experience intimacy with the Father. Consider the contrast between the spirit of slavery, whereby fear governs much of what or how we relate to God, versus the spirit of adoption, whereby intimacy governs much of how we relate to our Heavenly Father. We get to address it as Abba, Father, a term of endearment. And intimacy, welcoming closeness and emotional nearness and warmth. We sing of it in our hymns. My God is reconciled. His pardoning voice I hear. He owns me for his child. I can no longer fear. With confidence I now draw nigh. And Father, Abba, Father, cry. Adoption is a family idea where God establishes us as his children and heirs. Closeness, affection, and generosity are at the heart of the relationship. To be right with God the judge in justification is a great thing, but to be loved and cared for by God the Father is greater still. Because of our adoption, we experience assurance of our belonging to the family. Reading verse 16. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. The Spirit of God somehow comes alongside us and gives us assurance that we truly belong to God's family. There's an inner witness in the heart that convinces us that God the Father doesn't only love people in general, but you and me in particular. Even with our sins and blemishes, we are not strangers. We are not mere acquaintances. We are not guests. We are members of the family. We belong. Because of our adoption, we experience a glorious future inheritance. We see in verses 16 and 17, we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ. In ancient times, the first son was the heir. Of course, all the children were loved, but the heir got the largest share of the wealth. To be fellow heirs with Christ, Paul is saying that what is in store for us is so grand, so glorious that it will be, and it will feel as though we each got the largest share of our Abba Father's wealth. Number four, because of our adoption, we experience present sufferings. We are fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him. Verse 17, suffering is a given for the child of God. This passage doesn't elaborate on the kinds of suffering we are subject to, only that it is part and parcel to belong to the family. Perhaps you're feeling the loss of your mother. That's a suffering, for sure. Perhaps you're overcome with more rejoicing that mom is no longer suffering herself. Perhaps you're experiencing some other kind of suffering. I invite you to do what I'm doing myself. I am preaching to myself. Rick, your father is always there. Your father is always wise. Your father is always loving. And your father is always son. And therefore is always worthy of my fullest trust. He never asks his children to suffer needlessly. So if you and I are suffering, when you and I suffer next, it must be needful. Even if we don't understand why. All of our present sufferings must eventually give way to a future glory. Once again, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. So because of our adoption, we experience intimacy with the Father, assurance of our belonging to his family, a glorious future inheritance, and present sufferings. The praise of God for Romans chapter 8. What comforting and encouraging truths to lift the soul in difficult times. I want to close with a story that I found in Robbie Zacharias' autobiography. Perhaps you've read it. It's called Walking from East to West. Robbie, if you don't know, is a world-renowned traveling evangelist. Apologies. He's been all over. He writes, I was in Vancouver for a lecture when my phone rang late at night. Hello? I answered. Brother Robbie. With that one sound, I knew immediately who it was. Ken. After Vietnam, I hadn't known whether my young interpreter friend was even still alive. Now, as my excitement gushed forth, he explained, I'm in San Francisco. What are you doing here, Ken? Have you got time to listen? Boy, did I ever. After Vietnam fell, Ken was captured by the Viet Cong and imprisoned. They accused him of collaborating with the CIA, since he had worked with missionaries. In prison, they worked him over, telling him again and again that he had been brainwashed by Westerners. They took away his Bible and forbade him to speak English. There is no such thing as God, came the refrain from his captors, day after hellish day. The hour finally came when Ken wondered, maybe they're right. Maybe there is no such thing as God. As he thought back to some of my sermons, he wondered if perhaps I had been deluded too. That night he went to bed muttering to himself, I'm through. When I wake up in the morning, no more God, no more prayer. The new day dawned, and the commanding officer of the prison barked out the assignments for the day. Ken was to clean the latrines. It was the ultimate form of indignity for the prisoners. He spent the entire day in those inhospitable surroundings. His final task was to empty the trash cans, which were filled with soiled toilet paper. All day long he labored with reminders to himself, no God today, no God. But as his work was coming to an end, something in the last trash began to catch his eye. It was a piece of paper with printed type. As Hen looked closer, he saw it was in English. Hungry to read this language again, he looked around to make sure nobody was watching. He hastily rinsed off the filth and tucked the paper into his pocket. That night, after everyone had fallen asleep, he carefully took out his flashlight and removed the still damp paper from his pocket. In the upper right-hand corner of the page were the words, Romans. Most of the passage I just read to you that God had chosen for himself. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Again, begin. Of all the scripture verses he had known, these were the ones he needed most to hear. The next morning when he saw the commanding officer, he asked him, "Sir, would you mind if I clean the latrines again?" Yen did not know in the beginning that the officer himself had been tearing out those pages from the Bible and using them for toilet paper. He ended up collecting numerous passages from the book of Romans. Again, praise God for Romans chapter 8. And again, no wonder God wanted so much of it read and preached here today. May these eternal truths comfort and encourage you for the rest of your journey to see. Our next hymn is an insert, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Else."
Thank you.
standing, but after the benediction, you'll be seated again, and we'll listen to this rendition of Just As I Am. When that is over, then the pallbearers and family will escort Donna's body out, and we will stand to sing When Peace Like a River is Found in your hymnal, 445. And afterwards, on the singing, we will leave the sanctuary from front to back. And of course, you're all invited to come to the graveside service at 2 o'clock. And refreshments immediately follow. So, would you please stand for the benediction? The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Heavenly Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
His own hands secure.